The program contains scenes which may alter your state of mind.
Hello and welcome to another edition of Screen Test, a chance for you to pit your skill and wit against our contestants here in the studio. A little later we'll have an entry for this year's Young Filmmakers Contest, but first, here's a clip. It comes from the erotic adventures of Robinson Crusoe. Let's take a look.
Maybe this'll help you to remember. And the one, and the two, and the three!
Adventures of Robinson Crusoe. First question, can anybody tell me, how did Robinson remind Friday about girls?
Did he show him two coconuts?
No, he didn't. There's a chance for a bonus. Nobody? Well, of course, he made them jiggle around in the stream. Let's move on.
Somewhere between sex and rock and roll lies drugs. That's the Mondo of Druggos that we turn our gimlet gaze to tonight. Where there are drugs, there's sure to be drug movies. And where there are drug movies, you will find me, because, let's face it, drug movies are cool. I would just like to go on record here, though, ladies and gentlemen, and state that I do not do drugs. Of course I don't. I'm a television presenter. But I wanted to ensure that this evening, despite the topic of the show, your television would also remain a drug-free zone, which is why I insisted that every member of the Mondo Rosso team take a urine test this afternoon, even those who never normally pass water. And you'll be pleased and not a little proud to know that everyone passed the test with flying colours, even the cameramen, except for Dave. But he assures me it's just the medication he's taking for trapped wind, so we're going to let him go this time and everything's fine. That's the team all declared clean and sober, but what about our studio audience, ladies and gentlemen, some of whom, it must be said, have suspiciously large pupils for this time of night? Well, to further reassure you, the home viewer, I've requested the presence of the BBC's in-house drug sniffer dog, Featherlight. So if you'd bring Featherlight in now, please. As you'll see, he is ribbed for your pleasure. Featherlight will be rooting around among our audience just to be on the safe side here. So if you'd like to go and do your sniffing, Featherlight, don't bother with me, I'm clean as a whistle. By the end of the evening, I hope that you too will be a hopelessly addicted drug movie junkie. One of the many things these films you'll see tonight had in common is that rather like those recent Lover's Guide videos, these films actually had two goals: to educate and titillate, which, coincidentally, was my old school motto. For example, take this precious moment from the 1954 film Girl Gang. The posters claimed it would reveal all about the scandal of drug-using youth, serving as a warning to parents, dogs and their young alike. In reality, it comes across more like a beginner's guide, with scenes like this one showing any interested parties how to shoot up for that all-important first time.
Dissolve it in a spoon with a few drops of water. And then you heat the drug with a match. You then absorb it into the hypodermic like this. Put your leg up on the couch. Inject the stuff under the skin. On a girl, the leg is best. Few will get to see the needle marks.
Ha, 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 ha.
Drugs, the devil's candy. That's our theme tonight, and to hash over some favourite drug movie moments with me now is a man who is here on a strict cash for laughs basis, which means that thanks to his haircut alone, he's already 20 quid better off. Exuding the powerful aroma of high karate that is the mark of a real man, welcome Alan Davis. Alan, I can't begin to tell you how lovely it is to have you here.
It's lovely to be here.
You a film fan, generally?
Not half.
Now, you've been watching the 1967, dare I say, classic, Weird World of LSD.
Well,
it's
not really a classic.
You don't think so?
No.
Well, many would disagree with you on that count.
It's the best film with LSD in the title, definitely.
Oh, well, there's a couple of other ones. There's one called Psych Out that's very good indeed.
Show me that.
No, I just showed you this one and tried to pretend it was a classic. So the 1967 film, Weird World of LSD,
yeah.
You've watched it. Does it serve as a warning for the perils of mind-bending drugs, or do you think it's something of a come-on?
I think it depends on your personality, Jonathan. For me, it's something of a come-on. For you, it's a warning of the perils of mind-bending drugs.
Why do you think me in particular would
well,
be warned
off? If you took some mind-bending drugs now, how would you come out of dress tomorrow? Plasties are all your real toys, aren't they?
Some of them might have come from my little toy
you're
box.
You're on at the beginning of the show, so I've never done a drug in my life. And look at your dollies. It's an odd film, frankly.
But you enjoyed it, though?
I did enjoy it.
What do you think is the message, the drug message, in the movie? Do people come away with some sort of idea that LSD is a joyride?
It's supposed to enhance your natural personal demons or joys. As they claim.
When you do that, why do you do the signal that was used in Benny Hill for large breasts?
Because you've deliberately put me in a chair where your elbows slide up and you end up doing that.
That's another TV myth exploded. Benny Hill wasn't actually being at all saucy then. His hands were coming that way because of the chair.
This is also a Jackie Mason chair. He does
very much so. But the movie, let's get back to the movie. LSD in all its glory. What do you think are actually the key moments in the movie?
Well, one of my favourite clips, I've got some to show you.
Funny that.
I asked the bloke upstairs if he'd put them on this screen.
Yeah.
Oh, here's one now, look.
Okay, so talk us through this. What's going on here?
See, now this bloke...
He's done some LSD.
He's had some LSD, obviously. And he's singing, oh, I wish I was on one of them chairs. Look at his elbows. Yeah. And then he sees a chicken. Now, there's three possibilities. Either he's had a long, hard shift at Kentucky Fried Chicken, he's lost it. Or he's been watching too much Play Away.
Yeah. Strong possibility.
Because you can see, when it goes back to the chicken, you'll probably be able to see the shape of Brian Cant behind him.
The evil mastermind, Brian Cant.
Or he had some awful CSE arts and crafts incident and he can't.
Do you think it could be that they've actually mixed the drug with some Knorr chicken cubes, perhaps? Because that does look like the Knorr chicken to me.
Allegedly, he thinks he's flying.
After this, I believe he went on to form a very successful band called Suede, didn't he?
No, he's in Pulp. He's a guitarist in Pulp.
So this, of course, is what presumably, and none of us here would know, but presumably what would happen to you if you did try the dreaded acid?
Yeah, that's it. If you were thinking of chickens at the time, this is the important point.
So it doesn't seem perhaps as harmful as many people have made out.
No.
Let me talk to you briefly about movies generally. You're at the cinema.
Yeah.
You're just waiting for the movie to start,
yeah.
And that advert comes on with the snake going,
oh,
there
yeah.
are thieves in this cinema.
Yeah.
Do you, Alan Davis, leap forward and check for your belongings, or are you cool, do you lean back, not a care in the world?
Well, I'll get my feet up straight away if there's a snake about.
Yeah. I don't think you better take it quite that literally.
Well, I'm that sort of a bloke.
Right.
So you... Or I might try and make a citizen's arrest, obviously, there's a thief about.
Why, obviously.
Yeah. First thing you think of, isn't it?
It's a thief, you
allow
of,
me.
Of course. I very much like The Weird World of LSD. Of course, that was a movie that didn't come around until the 60s. But let me ask you just a general knowledge question here. When do you think drug movies first started appearing? When did films that had drug as their backbone, as the main driving force, first appear?
In the Middle Ages.
Yeah. Close, but not quite there. First one I've tracked down was 1929. There's a film called
really?
The Mysteries of the Leaping Fish.
See, my dad wasn't even born then.
Well, that has nothing to do with
nothing
this.
To do anyone.
1929, Mysteries of the Leaping Fish, starring Douglas Fairbanks, who played a detective called Coke Any Day.
No.
Not subtle, perhaps. I'm sure it had its fans. There you go.
Jest.
We haven't
Is
got a tip to
the
say.
Is that a well-known abbreviation for the drug cocaine?
It was the drug cocaine, and he had a clock in his wall in this film that said, eat, sleep, drink, dope. I want to show a clip now from Weird World of LSD as well, because I like the movie very much indeed. This is another thing that apparently can happen to you if you take too much of this stuff.
Oh, yeah.
Perfectly normal woman, happens to be naked, suddenly, under the influence, sees a large black spot. Obviously alarmed, but what's it going to do? Whoops, there you go, suddenly she's a weeder's wife. get away, she says. You're just a shoddy piece of early special effects technology. there's another one that appears and immediately goes
hey,
for the what we refer to here as the
tits.
The tits. And here we see, whoops! And I'm sure when this was first shown, the cry of "How's your father?" went up in cinemas across America. What was that cross there? Was that X marks the spot, or was
X
it saying no entry? What was going
X
on there?
X marks
do you think?
The spot. That is.
Yeah, yeah. I don't even know what that means either.
I mean, stay out me bum.
Slimy.
You just made it very clear for all of us. What was the first movie you ever saw? Let me ask you about your cinema going habits. Can you remember the first movie you ever saw at a cinema?
Zulu. And I remember it because there was an interval, which you don't have so much in the pictures now.
I remember intervals. The first interval I remember seeing, I went to see Chitty Chitty Bang Bang. There was an interval in the middle, and it was the bit, I don't know how well you remember this movie, where the car goes over the cliff before the wings open. And he went to the interval, and I remember thinking, that was it, the movie's over. What a depressing movie to take a kid to. Entire family killed in flying car that doesn't know why.
What,
it scarred me mostly for years.
Obviously, during the interval, was add some LSD, and then it would have really jazzed up the second half.
I had a very, very sedate childhood. Let's have a look at another tip here. This is another one you've chosen from the Weird World of LSD, I believe, to amuse and educate us.
What is he running from? He doesn't know.
A little known fact, this movie was obviously voiced over by Clement Freud just before he did the Minced Morsels advert that made
his name. Is, what's going on here is all the shops are shut. And he's thinking, oh no, I've been sent out down the garage to get some milk. I've got a tea bag stewing in a cup, and everyone's going to have the right up when I get home.
And this milk-deprived fear is enhanced
driving him on, and he's running slightly in an odd way, like he's doing the twist. He's been running all night because he went out about 2 a.m. to the garage. And if you watch it, he's like the bloke in Ben-Hur who died.
The man who actually genuinely died in the making of Ben-Hur.
He dies.
You think this might well be a snuff movie?
He's thinking, I'm on camera, but I'm going to make the most of it. He's dead, that bloke.
And I think that serves not just as a warning against the dangers of drugs, but also so as to be very careful when you buy your shirts that they're not very poor quality.
Yeah.
Because that can part far too easily.
You should use the buttons. Don't go ripping them. That's what the bloke in the shop would say, isn't it?
There's another movie I'd like to look at now, which isn't The Weird World of LSD. This is another drug movie, probably the most famous of these kind of drug movies, I think. Most people have heard of it. I don't know how many have actually seen it, which is why I wanted to show a clip. It's Reefer Madness from 1937. This is the kind of classic of the anti-pot movies.
My dad was four then.
Was he?
Yeah.
Right. This was the possibly the classic anti-pot movie, and you'll see why now.
Now, that's a reefer there in her mouth.
Right. She's got the hand-rolled cigarette. Marijuana, I believe it's called. And of course he's deranged by inhaling. And he just wants, as people do under this substance, he wants loud, fast piano music, and he wants it now.
In one hand she's rolling another joint, and now he's thinking, I know this one, hang on, I know the words. Hang on, oh, he's coming
to me.
He's rubbing his nipple, now he's singing, oh no, I can't remember the chorus.
Or maybe he missed the moment he was meant to come in at, and he's now despondent.
He's thinking, damn, I'm going to have to wait for it to come round again. If only I had that joint, I'd have remembered.
The emotional highs and lows of drug use laid bare for the youth of America there. Well, you see, now that would scare me into not wanting to ever take that stuff. Because I don't even have a piano, so what would I do?
I had a piano when I was about four.
Did your dad have a piano?
Yeah.
Oh, good. Yeah. Let me ask you, do you miss the days when movies were classified as X instead of 18? Because I used to like going to see an X film. I don't like going to see 18.
X films, they were always in the distance for me. Double A's, they were the challenge.
Well, it's just a double A for you.
Could you get into a double A or not? Jaws was an A, wasn't it? Do you remember that?
I think it possibly was an A, yeah, but it was quite scary.
It was terrifying. I came out of Jaws thinking I'll never be scared of anything again. And then I saw Mary Poppins.
There.
Frightening.
We want to have a look at one more clip. One more clip from a movie here. This is from a movie called Blonde on a Bum Trip. I don't think you could release a movie with that title anymore without people getting confused, but here it is. It's from 1968. The director was, of course, Ralph Morrow. Who knows what happened to him? I think what's happened here is that guy said, everyone back to my place, and, of course, he's had far more result than he ever imagined possible.
Yeah.
But because of the drugs, he's gone for the poodle. If anything would put you off mind-altering substances, is this man's cautionary tale, isn't it?
Look, she's got no patience with that cuddly toy. Straight on. Hello, go. Hello. Oh, now, you see, now he's thinking that there are two of them.
So is he imagining the second woman, do you think?
He's clearly imagining them, because as you can see, three people but only two beds.
He's confused.
So one of them is clearly not there.
Now, I believe this scene is indicates what people who I know have actually tried drugs have told me. There's a thing where they get a craving for food late at night, which results in a drive to a service station called the Munchies.
Yeah.
And this shows what happened before they had service station. She's got a craving for food. This is a terrible, terrible
scene.
She's
gone down the garage.
Look, she's gone straight for the boots. She cannot control her inhuman appetite. Alan, I've enjoyed your company so much, I would like to adopt you.
That's right.
Okay, well, see me afterwards for the paperwork. Ladies and gentlemen, Alan Davis. Alan, I'd like you to linger. Do you like girls?
Not half.
Do you like tough girls?
Yeah.
Do you like tough, drug-using, motorbike-riding, man-abusing, leather-wearing girls with a mouth as fast as a Harley and as dirty as a used oil wag?
My heart's beating.
Who doesn't? Well, look no further, my friends. You won't be surprised to learn that those involved in the sleazier end of the movie market were not slow to discover that by combining the potent sexuality of catfighting, chicks, nudity, cussing and drug use, they had movies that would, figuratively, gang-bang 'em in the drive-ins. 1956 was a vintage year for babes gone bad, kicking off with Robert C. D'Urtano's Gun Girls.
These young girls, rounded up by the police the night before, are from tough neighborhoods. Born on the wrong side of the street and raised along its sidewalks. These girls learn fast. They know how to fight with their knees, their elbows, their teeth. How to hold a blackjack, how to spot a cop, how to roll a marijuana.
By the mid-60s, girls had got even tougher. Teenage gang debs promised to tell it like it was. In reality, of course, it told it like sleazy fat producers wanted it to be, and thank heavens for that. Violent vixens on film proved the ideal way to lure young potheads in off the street and provided a much-needed antidote to all that peace and love nonsense and yeah-yeah music that the youth of the 60s were filling their idle heads with. But when it comes to downright nasty girlies who'll do anything to get what they want, then Herschel Gordon Lewis's She-Devils on Wheels is just the ticket. Made back in 1968, these hog-riding, mini-skirted chicklets wanted nothing to come between them and their mean machines, especially men. Get off the road. Movie legend has it that Herschel, ever keen for realism, especially when it came cheap, passed over the usual actressy suspects and hired a bunch of real-life cycle gang girlies, the Cutthroats, to bring their tried and tested brand of genuine gut-wrenching mayhem and thrill-crazy violence to the driving screens of the USA. Sure, what they were glamorizing here is wrong. It's mean, it's cheap, it's nasty. But face facts, who would you rather be terrorized by? A bunch of overweight, hairy-assed geezers on motor gootsies or hard-as-nails, mascara-wearing dolls in go-go boots? Your Honor, I rest my case.
You said that film was made in 1968, but I am certain it was made in 1967.
She Devils on Wheels, Herschel Gordon Lewis, is definitely 1968.
My dad screened it at my first birthday party.
Well, there's only one way to sell this.
What?
Bring out the gimp.
No, the gimp's asleep, can't wake him up.
Well, I guess you'd better wake him up then. Gimp? Gimp, sorry to wake you. She-Devils on Wheels, Herschel Gordon Lewis, 1967 as Alan claims or 1968 as I maintain.
Oh, She-Devils on Wheels, Jonathan. I think that was 67.
You see, I'm right. It was 1967. See you again. Put him away. Thank you.
Ta.
These days, you'll find this voluptuous Venus happily posing naked at her local art centre. But despite that level of exposure, she still manages to keep her rather large secret remarkably well hidden. With the sort of horrific past that Jacqueline Pearce has, you'd need an artistic genius to really capture it.
Jacqueline, you are the star of two of my favourite Hammer horror movies, Plague of Zombies and The Reptile. There's a lot of blood in Plague of Zombies, of course. You get completely splattered and splashed with it. Can you remember, what did they use for the blood?
Mine.
Jacqueline gave such good head in Plague of Zombies that the producer made her an offer she couldn't refuse.
He said, you have a wonderful face for film, and then cast me as a reptile.
You know, somehow that is, as far as Hammer and that period in British movies go, I think that is the perfect memory to have.
Well, never mind. What happened to the drug sniffer dog, Featherlight? Has he come back here?
I don't know.
If it weren't so late at night, I'd ask you all to stand up and pay your respects to someone who, in my humble opinion, is the greatest living English film director. A man whose work occasionally gives the impression that he is himself under the influence of a mind-destroying cocktail of Class A substances, although he assures me it's all the work of his peculiar yet inspired imagination. We should perhaps all be very afraid. Here's a clip from one of his, Tommy.
My work's begun. Now look at him. He's never been more alive. His head is shaking, his fingers clutch. Watch his body rise. I'm the Jedi, I'm the queen, and I'm the power star. I'm the Jedi, I'm guaranteed to break your little heart.
Roll up for Mr. Ken Russell. Ken, it's marvellous to see you. It's great to have
you.
You too. Just watching that and thinking generally about your films, I thought even when the movies you made that weren't dealing directly with drugs or had drugs in them anyway, they had a kind of hallucinatory quality to them, I wonder. Is that something you deliberately wanted, and was it hard to achieve?
No, very easy. I just put on a bit of classical music and I'm away.
So you didn't have to do any actual research with the substances yourself?
Oh, I was encouraged to do so when I made Altered States in Hollywood. I'd had three puffs of marijuana in my life.
On separate occasions or in one sitting?
I can't remember. My mind's gone blank. Anyway, so the powers that be at the studio, I won't mention what it was, thought I should imbibe some substance. And so I found in my car glove compartment one day a plastic packet.
Or baggy, as I believe it's referred to.
Is that what it is? And I had a rainbow on it, presaging my greatest film. And in the packet were some very thin mushrooms.
And was it like a sort of a pot noodle soup thing?
Well, it was extremely like it. I should have drunk it instead of bitten it.
So you chewed it. You didn't take it while you were just about to drive home, did you?
My wife and I, after Sunday lunch at Shelley Winter's pool, we'd rented a house.
And we're very civilised.
That's not funny.
Anyone for coffee, mushrooms?
We thought that would be the time. It wasn't a working day. So we both took a nibble, like Alice in Wonderland. We didn't grow big or small, we stayed extremely the same, but the surrounding foliage of the pool, which was pretty jungly, being Los Angeles, and there was a bit of a breeze blowing, and the breeze increased to a wind, all these sharp-edged, sort of terrible jungle plants seemed to be advancing on us, and we got really scared. But the most frightening thing of all was that as we went on and the plants got closer and closer, there was something that looked like Shelley Winters in the pool. It was a great big lilo. Blue. She did have a blue bathing costume. But anyway, and...
She's not here to defend herself.
I know, but she will be the first to agree.
Well, I was big in blue.
She was at one time. And this big rubbery thing...
Rubbery and all now,
seemed to be trying to get out of the pool and devour me and my missus.
Do you think Shelley was invited really you over with that in mind, thinking like invite
maybe
the Russells over for lunch?
Maybe she turned
literally
up after lunch, I don't know, was just taking a dip. So anyway, we fled. We fled inside Shelley's home, slammed the doors, and went to bed.
Let me ask, some of the movies we've seen tonight, obviously exploitative of the nature of drugs, and people often criticise them and say, what you're doing here is you're presenting it in a fun and glamorous way, and young folks, easily led,
mm-hmm. far too quick to follow, could be led astray into the terrible world of drug abuse. Do you think there's any truth in that whatsoever?
Well, I know that when my film Altered States opened, the hallucinatory druggy film in Westwood, California, where all the students hang out, they had these 20 huge speakers around, big screen, all that business. And all the kids got bored, didn't bother with the dialogue. They just were smoking pot in the foyer. And one would be peeping into the cinema and say, "First hallucination, boys! Wow!" And then everyone would run in and be blown away, smoking away, taking dope, whatever. And then when the dialogue started, they went out again and took more. So I think,
I was like that with Zulu.
Yeah. They're better clearing up after that crowd's been in, though, like some whinges and
bags.
Ken, sticking with the very personal subject of you personally taking drugs, you haven't done that many. Do you ever look back and say, I wish I'd done a whole lot more, maybe as much as the size of the Isle of Man?
No, because I know myself. I know if I had four puffs of marijuana instead of three, I'd have been hooked for life.
You really think so?
Yeah, I would, because I was hooked on snuff.
You were hooked on
snuff. Why does everyone laugh on snuff? What is funny about it? What is funny about being addicted to snuff?
What's the sensation of snuff?
Well, it's Oliver Reed used to call it instant high. I mean, I don't know how instant other highs are, but I mean, it is goes straight to the bloodstream.
I don't even know what it is, though.
What is it? Well, it's ground tobacco, basically. So it is it's neat nicotine, and you sniff it up, and it goes wink into your lungs.
Does it always go wink, or does it sometimes go wonk?
It sometimes goes wonk.
But surely, if Ollie Weed, of all people, says this is the greatest high of all, surely you'd avoid it immediately.
Yeah, well, I tried to give it up.
Ken, I want to say thank you simply for being you, Ken Russell. And I would also like to say thank you to Alan Davies simply for sitting so close to Ken Russell. As I said at the top of the show, we in no way condone drug use here. However, if our programme has unintentionally stimulated an interest in illegal substances and you want to know more, then contact your local dealer. Or you can send in for our fact sheet, which contains more details on drugs and where you can get them. It also includes some gratuitous pictures of naked young men and women doing it. Simply write your name and address on a piece of Rizla paper, then fall asleep and forget all about it.
Next week on Mondo Rosso.
Doubtless there'll be selected highlights of tonight's show on Points of View, but failing that, I'll be back in just 7 days, during which time I'd like you to live your lives as Elvis did when he said in Roustabout, "This is one grease monkey who won't slide." Until then, his LSD's got a hold on me from the film Blonde on a Bum Trip.
And the Mondo Rosso season continues in 10 minutes on BBC Two with tonight's late film, The Cool and the Crazy.
On the other hand...